Good morning, everybody. I am Tathagato, one of the co-founders of SigTuple. We founded SigTuple back in 2015 with an idea of applying the latest advances in AI towards the healthcare domain. And incidentally, neither me nor any of my co-founders had any background in healthcare at all. The last time I studied biology was in class 10. So it has been an interesting, if not difficult, journey so far. So in today's talk, I'll be presenting a few challenges that we have come across and how we have solved them, and also the challenges that face healthcare industry as a whole in general. So our motto is data-driven intelligence for healthcare. What we want to do is to make sure that every medical decision taken is guided by data and AI in the future. The outline of the talk is as follows. I will start with the challenges that face the healthcare industry today, and then followed by what are the possible areas of application of AI and ML in the healthcare industry. And finally, we'll give you a few glimpses of what we are doing at SigTuple in this area. The challenges and opportunities in healthcare today. Now, healthcare as we know it today has several problems. The first problem is the lack of doctors. Now, if you search for the number of doctors in India in Google, the results that come up are as follows. All of them actually talk about the lack of doctors in India. And the rural India houses 68% of the Indian population, whereas only 10% of our doctor population lives in the rural areas, which makes it extremely difficult for people in rural areas to access quality healthcare. And this infographic, I don't know whether it's fully visible on the screen or not, gives you a doctor to patient ratio across the world. The redder areas are where the problem is more acute, whereas the greener areas where things are still better. As you can see, much of India is in the yellow and red zone, and almost the whole of Africa is in the red zone. So the problem now is that we have an abysmal doctor to patient ratio, and as a result, a lack of reach of quality healthcare. Now the only way to solve this is through technology. You can neither grow new doctors overnight, nor can you force doctors to leave their comfort, their urban comfort, and relocate to rural areas. This is a mimic. I mean, no disrespect to doctors here, but at many times, the doctors do is mentally taxing. And this leads to variability, inaccuracy, and inefficiency, especially when it comes to diagnosis from visual medical data. Let us take a very common example of malaria. Now, malaria is not very common in Bangalore, but if you just go outside, maybe to Mangalore or the coastal areas, it's very endemic over there. And till today, the gold standard for malaria detection or malaria treatment decision is manual microscopy. WHO mandates that a single malaria sample which is suspected to be of malaria be examined for 20 minutes by a pathologist. Now, a typical lab in Mangalore gets around 300 samples a day, suspected malaria cases. Now, do you think they actually get to spend 20 minutes examining that sample? The answer is probably no. So again, technology can help this. And finally, it's a very simple problem. It's the cost. The quality medical equipment costs a lot of money, which means that even the biggest hospitals or the biggest hospital chains can only have the best instruments at their central locations only. Which means, again, that the people at the peripheral centers do not have access, ready access to their latest technology. And this is, again, augmented by the problem that technology changes very fast, but upgrades are only possible through replacements. So if I bought an MRI machine today, and if a new version or a better version comes up tomorrow, then what will happen is that I have to throw away my existing MRI machine and buy a new machine. There is no simple way to upgrade. This is one of the challenges that we are trying to solve at SigTuple with a special emphasis. So we have talked about the problems. Now, this obviously means that there are a lot of opportunities for us to apply AI and ML into the healthcare industry. So what are the typical opportunities that come to mind? One is medical signal recognition and segmentation for disease detection, which I think Kiran is also going to talk about after this, is that you get a medical image, maybe an MRI or a CT or a X-ray, and you automatically detect whether this person has a tumor or a cancer, some kind of cancerous growth. The next is emergency medicine. Now, emergency medicine is a completely data-driven discipline. The doctors say that I do not treat the patient. I look at the numbers, not the patient. Now, a machine is much better at looking at numbers than a human being. So this is actually an area where AI can make a lot of difference. The next is holistic healthcare. Now, when we go for a treatment, there are multiple tests that are done. I go to the laboratory to get my blood test done. Then I might be going for an ECG, maybe a chest X-ray or whatever. And then all these data needs to be collated together to make a final diagnosis for other, decide the course of treatment. Again, AI can help in a big way in this, to collect data from multiple sources and suggest the best course of treatment. IBM Watson is talking about this in a big way these days. Drug discovery. Drug discovery has a lot of experimentation. They try out with different molecules. There are, first of all, there is a text-based data which is analyzed. Then there is an image-based data as well, where they actually take thousands of molecules and see how they react with the different kinds of cells. And this is again done through what is called as a high-content screening. Due to the manual nature of the process, they can only sample parts of the choices that they make. AI-based solution can actually help it, make it much more comprehensive and bring down the cost of drug discovery. And this list is ever growing. Every day we make new advances in healthcare, there is a potential application of AI into it. Now today I'm going to talk about mostly about medical signal analysis. And now what is a medical signal? So the medical signals come in multiple shapes and forms. So we have signals from ECG, which is a one-dimensional signal, to a CT, MRI, or an OCT, which is a three-dimensional. And people are talking about four-dimensional images as well, where you're looking at a fetal ultrasound. And this interpretation of signals is very, very subjective. It varies a lot from one doctor to another. We have seen that the inter-observer variability between what is normal and what is abnormal, or what type of cell this is to what other type of cell this is, if you give it to two doctors or three doctors, the inter-observer variability can be as high as 30%. And AI can, so therefore AI can help standardize the abnormality detection process. It can enable even a junior doctor to actually diagnose or treat patients with the same level of expertise as a senior doctor. In fact, I myself have seen this happening in a lab where a junior pathologist will come running to the senior saying, "Ma'am, I found a cell which looks like a cancerous cell to me in this blood sample. Can you please come and have a look?" Now, the junior pathologist at the central hub of a laboratory has that luxury. But a junior pathologist sitting at a rural health center or a rural hospital does not have that luxury. This is where AI can help. So I'm going to talk about a few advances in AI towards the medical diagnosis, medical signal analysis in the recent years now. So we'll start with ECG. Now ECG is, on the face of it, it's a very simple thing. There are a few lines which go. There are patterns and abnormalities in there. And it is a very effective, and not only in terms of detecting heart failures, but also in terms of cost. And it has been perfected over decades. Yet, the automated algorithms that have been built so far for ECG signal analysis fall woefully short. The GE ECG machine, or many of the ECG machines, actually come with some inbuilt indicators. They say, okay, this might be a heart attack and all. But the false positive rates are so high that the doctors do not pay any attention to it at all. But this has changed recently. Now, there's an ML group at Stanford came up with an ECG analysis platform, which actually they claim is detecting arrhythmia, which is a type of early indicators of heart attacks, with the level of competence of a cardiologist. What they have done is they have actually used a single lead ECG. So when we normally do an ECG, we have 12 leads fitting into different parts of our body, but they have used a single lead ECG, which could be a wearable device as well, and use that to detect potential chances of arrhythmia. Now, this actually opens up a new avenue altogether. Now, I might be wearing a fitness tracker on my hand, and if that keeps syncing my heartbeat data to a cloud, I can actually say that, okay, this person is at risk of heart attack in the next 48 hours. And they have used, they have some 64,000 samples they could collect it through this wearable device, and they trained a 32-layer deep neural network. And there is another company called Cardiologs in France, which has recently got FDA approval for their ECG analysis algorithm. They have trained on some 200,000 samples. But the problem is that both of these solutions target only one particular type of disease, which is arrhythmia. So what is missing still till now is that a comprehensive ECG analysis platform, which can detect all types of diseases. Next, I'll come to hematology. Hematology is basically the study of blood cells. So this is what a pathologist sees in a blood smear slide under a microscope. The blue things are called white blood cells, which give us immunity. The others are the red blood cells. And the small blue dots over here are called platelets, which help in clotting of the blood. What they do is, by looking at these pictures, is they classify these white blood cells into different types: neutrophil, lymphocytes, monocytes, eosinophils, and so on. They look for abnormal morphologies. When a disease occurs, these white blood cells undergo morphological changes, which is indicative of the diseases. And they also look for parasitic infection, like malaria, in the white blood cells. Now, the question is, can AI automate the process? The answer is yes. There are actually quite a few solutions for hematology automation in the market today. We have companies like Medica, CellaVision, Vision Hima, and there's a machine which Roche is also coming out with, which actually automatically detect, go through these images and come up with decisions. We have our own solution called Shonit, which we are working on, and I'm going to talk about it next. So what they do is basically they have an automated microscope which takes pictures of the blood from multiple areas in the sample, and then they have an AI or NN-based algorithm to detect and classify the different cells. But the classification of blood cells is a phenomenally tough problem. I mean, there is so much of inter-observer variability that you can hardly be sure. And there is also no public data set on which a comparison can be made of different solutions. And all of these have varying degrees of accuracy. And most of these are actually pretty costly as well. For example, the CellaVision machine costs, I think, close to a crore, which makes it difficult for most laboratories in India to actually adopt that. And therefore, these solutions are yet to see widespread adoption in countries like India. There are several more applications. I'll just rush through them. One is detection of diabetic retinopathy from fundus images. Now, diabetes is becoming a more and more critical problem in our society today, mainly due to lifestyle and sometimes due to some other diseases as well. And diabetics affects the eye in a big way. It is one of the most common causes for blindness, and which is also preventable with proper treatment. Now, Google recently came up with this paper where they actually trained an algorithm with 128,000 images and came up with a F-score of some 0.95 towards detecting diabetic retinopathy versus normal. Baidu went one step ahead. They said, okay, I will not only say whether an image is affected with retinopathy or not, I will also point out which areas of that image are showing the changes due to retinopathy, which makes it more explainable to the doctor as to what the algorithm is saying. This is a 2017 paper itself, and there is a company in China called Heilgu who are also working on the same problems. Other applications include cancer detection histopathology images. In fact, this paper from 2013 is what prompted a lot of companies in this world to actually take on this challenge of applying AI towards the medical domain. These people were not doctors by profession. They were just software engineers or AI researchers. But they took on this problem and they came up with an algorithm and a solution which were actually competing with the level of accuracy of an expert human. So in SigTuple, I'll just rush through the remaining of it. AI plus, what we are trying to do is building smart screening solutions which address the base of the healthcare pyramid, which means that we want to target the tests which are voluminous and which differentiates between a healthy individual versus a diseased individual. We have this platform called Manthana, which is a continuously learning AI platform. It takes in visual medical data of all types, which are annotated by your experts. In some cases, the visual medical data is already available, for example, in diabetic fundus scans or x-rays. In certain other cases, like clinical pathology, the digital data itself is not available. So to counter that problem, we have built our own smart microscope, which is, as you can see from the image, it's a complete jugaad. Has a cell phone camera as the eye of the microscope, and it has a robotic attachment which automates the movement of the sample under the lens. And our first product is called Shonit. It is a platform for automated analysis of peripheral blood smear. So the way it works is this. The blood smear slide, which is prepared as a normal course of action in all laboratories, is scanned by the smart microscope, and the images are uploaded to Manthana in the cloud. The Manthana then actually analyzes these images. It takes out the individual cells, classify them, and comes up with a host of statistical parameters about this blood. And the report is now available to the reviewing doctor anywhere in the world on any web-connected device, which means that the doctor could be sitting here in Bangalore and the patient could be in Hubli, but still the diagnosis can go out, which was not possible till now. And after review by the doctor, the report is sent to the patient. This is a sample of the report. We have actually classified some of the cells and grouped them together. These are called lymphocytes. And these are the statistical parameters, like what is the cell diameter, what is the cell pallor ratio, and so on and so forth. And I'll just briefly talk about a problem that is an interesting problem that we are solving. I call it the camel problem. Now, if I look at this image, which is the camel, the black ones or the white ones? It's actually the white ones. This is taken from the top. And these are the shadows of the camels. Now, let us try to see if we can estimate the height and weight of each camel. It's possible. If we know what is the spatial resolution, if we know where the sun was, I can do some trigonometry and figure out what is the height of the camel, and I can probably figure out what is the ratio of height to weight and all, and do that. What we have is a picture like this. These are red blood cells. And what I want to do is find out what is the mean volume of the cell, what is the mean hemoglobin content of the cell, and how many of these cells are there in 1 microliter of blood? How is that possible? These are two-dimensional. These are not, even though they look circular, they are actually not spheres. They are toroidal in shape. How do you estimate the 3D parameters from 2D images? This is one of the problems that only one company, to the best of my knowledge, is working on in the world, which is Roche, and we are the seconds. So I'll be happy to talk about it later. And we have multiple other solutions based on Manthana. One is Adi, which is the solution for semen analysis. Shrava, which is the solution for urine analysis. Vaksha for chest x-rays. Drishti for retinal scans. And Shonit I've already talked about. Thank you. Questions?
Sure. We're almost out of time. One question, two questions maybe.
Hi, thanks. So this is an area where when someone's nailed it, it's going to be highly scalable, right? But when someone has nailed a problem, mm-hmm. In any medical diagnosis, it's going to be highly scalable. And providing it crosses enough of an accuracy, it's something that people will probably take up globally. So when you look at these companies or the examples you gave, like the Stanford ML project, they seem very laser focused on one particular problem.
Yes.
Right. And getting that problem right.
Right.
And it's going to be winner's going to take all at the end of the day. Why are you as a company doing so much
Yeah, it's basically to leverage the power of AI. Now, what is AI? Essentially, you feed it data. If you have enough data, building an algorithm or building a solution on top of it is not that difficult. So we have been actually able to leverage the power of our platform and the data sources that we have access to be able to simultaneously work on multiple problems. And at the end of it, when you're bringing a solution to a laboratory or a hospital, it is always more appealing if you actually solve a broader range of problems than rather solving one particular problem, I mean, with a laser focus.
We're about to, we're out of time, so please continue offline. Thanks. He's available.
Sure. You're welcome.